Years and Years is an epic tale about one very normal family based in Manchester and how their lives are changed and how they're affected over 15 years of political, technological, economical changes that all happen and how they cope with it, I guess. And it's just an absolute joy to be part of such an incredible production. Everything is magic in it. The writing, the cast, the crew, everything was just such a dream, and it's unbelievable to be a part of.
It's rare to have a narrative scope that spans such a long period of time. Can you talk about portraying those kinds of time jumps?
Absolutely. I think that was the biggest challenge definitely for me personally. 15 years is a long time to tell a story. But at the same time, as well as it being a challenge, it was really interesting as an actor to be able to grow with that character and find out where she would go, how her life would change, and also how she would keep the essence of who she was as well amongst all these changes.
Can you just talk a little bit more about your character specifically and where she fits into that family?
Oh, I absolutely adore Rosie. She's the youngest sibling. She's very feisty. She's independent. She's not afraid to say what she feels. And she is just trying to find her way in the world as the youngest sibling. And she adores her family. And for me personally, I would love to be a little bit more like her. So I've definitely taken away some of Rosie when I finish the job. And I hope she stays with me forever.
You talk about the amazing co-stars you have alongside you, because it's a wonderful smorgasbord of talent on that cast list.
Absolutely. There isn't one person who I wouldn't adore working with again. I think from day one, we all really gelled together as a family, and we really felt like that both on and off screen.
What is so magic about Russell's writing?
Oh, you know what? Everything he touches turns to gold. His writing is so real and it's truthful. Everything about what he says is so authentic. And so to be able to put his words into a reality on screen is definitely bucket list stuff for me.
What do you think television gives us as an audience and as a storyteller that you perhaps don't get from other forms of entertainment?
I think especially this project, it just felt so real and relevant. And it was so close to home, I guess. I mean, the storyline is so very relevant now, but also this family could be anyone on your street, and I think that's something that I really, really wanted to be part of, and I can't wait for everyone to see it.
Russell, it's amazing to have you here tonight. Can you start by telling us just a little bit about your character and where he fits into this wonderful tapestry of storytelling that Russell T. Davies has given us?
Yeah, I play a character called Daniel Lyons, who's part of the Lyons family. There's four siblings. I'm second from the youngest. The youngest is Rosie. I work for the council. My character deals with immigration and asylum seeking and refugees, and he's on the front line when that's all happening. He's experiencing the xenophobia that's happening and been sensationalised in the media, but he's there witnessing the plight of these people and how desperate they are and what they really need. He's a really decent guy. He's in a relationship. He's pretty settled, but he's unsure of what's like. Maybe the grass is greener, and then he experiences something, turns his world upside down, and that changes everything.
This is a story that spans quite a significant period of time. Can you talk a little bit about the vision of the future that this series paints for us? Because, I mean, like you've already said, it's delving into some of the most topical current stories and issues of our society. I'm curious, tonally, how you feel that the series presents that future.
Well, tonally, it's pretty bleak. It all looks a bit bleak in a minute. I don't see much hope politically right now. It's all a complete like mess. It's all scrambled egg at the moment. But the thing about this show is that, you know, even when stuff is going horrific around you, you still get up, you still go to work, you still make love, you still laugh, you still eat, you still clean, you still get on with your day. Even though stuff is going on, you have to, and you don't stay in bed all day. You get up and you get on with your life. And as a family, the way that this show works is that you're experiencing what is going on in the world on such a huge scale, but through the domesticity of a tight family in Manchester. And as everybody's experiencing whatever's going on in the world, you experience it through your nearest and dearest and through what's going on around you, and that's how you reflect on what's going on.
what it is about Russell T. Davies, apart from a brilliant name, that makes him such a very special talent.
Russell does have the best name in the world, but also his talent lies in his ability to create relationships, to flip on his head a scene where you're one scene, you're like funny laughing, then you're crying. The dialogue, just this is knack at writing dialogue, and the way you absolutely know exactly who that character is by reading it. I read 10 pages of this and I was like, I've got to do this. I know who this guy is. I've got to play this character. That's it. And that's why he is who he is, because he is able to, the nuance and the layering of all of his scripts are like, there's incomparable.
It's an amazing cast you've got alongside you as well. Can you talk a little bit about that experience for you and some of the very wonderful talents that you're sharing time with?
Yeah, incredible people I'm working with. It just makes you want to be better when you are surrounded by your peers and people who are, you know, inspirations and proper and the real deal. And as especially as a family, there's four of us in the family. There's Rory, Kinnear, Jessica Hines, myself and Ruth Madeley. And we are all very instinctive actors. And when we get together, we do these scenes where we are a family and we all are really connected. And it feels magic. And that's the whole reason I wanted to be an actor, is because you want to connect with other actors and experience that heightened other world emotions for an audience, to, you know, for entertainment, but to be able to experience that in the moment with these people, it's just, yeah, it's been a complete gift. It's been a completely joyous job every single day.
Apart from years and years, is there anything else in 2019 and beyond that we should also be looking out for and getting excited about?
Well, beyond just been announced today, I'm going to be part of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, Scott Rudin production of Joe Mantello's direction on Broadway, which I go over there January next year to rehearse. We start previewing March some point, so I'm doing that.
So I play a Eastern European guy called Victor Goria, who is seeking asylum in the UK, and he meets Daniel Lyons in a housing facility in the north of England, and they develop a relationship together, and kind of it all goes from there. The adventure starts, and yeah.
Can you talk about what is so very special about Russell's writing and why the themes of this particular project seem so timely and relevant today?
Yeah, well, I think what's amazing with Russell's writing is that it's kind of exploring these epic themes, but it's done in such a fragile way, and it's all about human contact, the show, and I think it can really relate to a lot of people because, you know, it's very cathartic and real, and it's about human emotion, and it's kind of all about how, you know, if the world's all going to shit, at least we can all be friends and we can all be kind of get through it together with love and kindness, and I think this show really, really explores that.
About togetherness, obviously it's an astonishing lineup of talent in the cast alongside you. Can you talk about that experience and what it means to be sharing screen time with some of these wonderful people?
I can't really believe it. I'm so grateful, and I'm just starting out my career and just finding out that I was kind of cast in a Russell T. Davies show alongside Rory Kinnear and Emma Thompson and Russell Tovey. It's been an absolute mad show, so I feel very lucky, very fortunate.
It's rare to have a narrative that spans as long as the course of this drama does. Can you talk a little bit about the time skips and playing a character that evolves over literally about 15 years?
Yeah, that was hard. I'm not going to lie. But the good thing about that was you kind of could explore age and you could explore... It gave you a little bit of time. And obviously the makeup department on Years and Years really helped you with that. Because you can't really... I mean, I'm 23 and I had to play a 37-year-old at the end of the show. And that's pretty... That's pretty weird. They put a little bit grey in my hair.
So we're here at the BFI celebrating television. What do you think as a medium TV gives both storytellers and an audience they perhaps don't get from other forms of entertainment?
I think it's something that people can... it enters a home. And I guess with cinema, you always go out to watch it and it's more of an event. This is kind of infiltrates your home. And when you watch TV at home, it adds a different dynamic and a different perspective on the show. And I think it kind of... It can be a little bit more emphatic and a little bit more powerful because you're sat on your couch, you're having your tea, and you're watching all these crazy things happen, and you're like, wow.
I play Celeste Lyons, who's married to Stephen Lyons. And they're sort of like a nuclear in and of themselves, actually, the Celeste and her children and Stephen. But it's forced to sort of mingle and be a part of that whole larger family. Within their sort of own little unit. She's a driving force. She's a powerhouse and rules the roost. This is the second thing that I've worked on with Russell T. Davies, and the man's a genius. You know, he'll have you laughing 1 minute, and you know the next minute you're in fits of tears, and you never know quite where what's going to happen next. It's so personable, his writing. Yeah, it's and funny, very bloody funny.
Rory, it's fantastic to have you joining us as well now. I guess the obvious question, can you talk about what it was about this script and this type of family drama that most interested you as a storyteller when you first saw the script?
Well, there are very few times in one's career, or at least mine, where you finish something within about half an hour, you think, yes. And I think Black Mirror was one of them, which made me just think, if this isn't brilliant, it's going to be our fault or my fault, because on the page it's incredible. And this is probably the one since then where immediately you thought, this feels so distinctive, so current, and so sort of novel feeling, that immediately you wanted to be involved with it.
Obviously, I mean, much like Black Mirror, this feels like a series that's going to hold up a bit of a mirror to our society and where we are now, where we're maybe heading. Can you talk a little bit about some of the themes, the subtext? Because obviously this is about one family, but it's about so much more than that, it feels as well, just from what we already know.
Yeah, I mean, it is about, even though we fast forward quite quickly to 5 years, then through 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years, and then ending up 15 years, it is speaking about today and our projections and our fears and our hopes and our dreams of what the future might look like. I think, in particular, you know, at the moment in our lives, there is such uncertainty, both worldwide and nationally, that it's a time where we're all looking at what life might be like, how we will survive, how will we go through in the next sort of decade or so. And it's one man's vision of what that might be, but it's so beautifully drawn, and it's not all depressing. It's funny, it's inspirational, it's hopeful, and it's full of the love that binds family together and that draws people together.
It was really interesting, actually, because I, initially, because we are going over the course of 15 years, had this whole thing planned and did a timeline and sort of mapped out that journey. But of course, on the day, you never shoot in sequence. You sort of just had to deal with what was on the page, respond emotionally to what was on the page on that particular day. Yeah, shooting day.
I think also being able to follow a relationship, and particularly rather than just a family relationship, a relationship between partners over that period of time, you have to have built up what that relationship was before you start the previous 15 years of their knowing each other, and then work, I guess, work out, if you're in episode 3, that's 2024, so, or 2026, so what happened in 2024, and there's a bit of mental arithmetic that you had to work out in between scenes, because quite often you were shifting between 26 and 28 and 24 all in the space of a day. But my secret weapon for remembering where I was is that in 2024 I had about this much hair, in 2025 I had about this much hair, and onwards. And if I knew that I was bald on top, I was moving on into episode 4 or 5.
Yes.
Obviously, Rory, you've had the good fortune to work with so many fantastic writers and storytellers. Can you talk about what makes Russell T. Davies such a very unique and precious talent?
I think the most sort of obvious preciousness, not his smarts or his imagination or his complete sort of inside-out knowledge of how TV works, is that he has an instinct for the popular, and how he manages to weave in such intelligence, such heart, such warmth and wit, all things that an audience loves, but also quite often with quite a dynamic message and quite a dynamic vision. You think Queer as Folk was at that time fairly groundbreaking television, and yet it didn't necessarily feel that way, because there was such universal truth to all the characters, and the way that they were drawn was so easily accessible, and how he manages to tackle challenging, diverse themes, but at the same time do it in such a digestible and relatable way, is, I think, what makes him unique.
So much excitement about Bond, as there always is. I'm curious, we already know that Daniel is going to be moving on and this is going to be his final outing. But I think the one question I think a lot of fans have been asking is, will this also be the last outing for the Bond family that's been built around Daniel? I mean, I know this is very early in the process for you, but do you have the sense that this would be your last time with the rest of that team, or do you think you might go beyond Daniel's last outing?
I've felt it's the last one for me every single time I've made one. So in that, this is no different from all the others. You never know if you're going to be in the next one. So this, you know, this has been the same as them all.
So you talked about what makes Russell such a very special storyteller. Obviously, there's been a change of guard with Bond 25. Carrie coming on board, I think those has re-excited people. Are you excited about getting a chance to work with him? Obviously, a very exciting director.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't worked with him before, and I love some of the stuff that he's done. So, yeah, we can't wait to get going.
Years and Years is a six-hour drama. It's about a family. It's a family saga, the Lions of Manchester. There's Gran, and then there's two brothers and two sisters and their various husbands and wives. And it's about how they survive the world. And you've seen great big family sagas through World War II or Upstairs Downstairs or Poldark. But this family saga goes into the future. We start in 2019. A baby is born, baby Lincoln. And the family gathers around and says, what will life be like? What will it be like in 10 years' time, 5 years' time? And the action zooms forward to 5 years' time, to 2024. And then every week we zoom forward another year and we see them surviving the politics, the economy, the changes, just as we are doing now. It's a metaphor for now, how we all survive in the world now, but told through a family saga where they're falling in love, where they're falling out of love, partners change, husbands and wives go, and terrible things happen, lovely things happen, love happens. So it's surviving the world. You see people surviving the world. This lovely family who I think people will unite behind and come and see. I think things are tough at the moment. Judging by the state of the world, and part of my reason for writing it is how mad and hot and wired the world is becoming, how politicized we are, or how fed up with politics we are, which is the same thing, really. But it would be terrible just to write, just to say that human nature is going into the bin. It does have hope in the end. It does have resolutions. It doesn't have false happy endings, but I think I always have to write for hope, and you always have to find a positive spin on stuff. They do go through the mill, this family. Terrible things happen. Shocking things happen. It's a proper drama in that sense, but survival in the end is the key to the whole thing. I think you'll come to the end of episode six. To be absolutely honest, the end of episode six is joyous, so I hope people get there. The cast is extraordinary, put together by Andy Pryor and his assistant, Ree McDade. And, do you know, you expect to get one of these people in a cast. If you had Rory Kinnear, you'd be like, fine, we've got our star. Jessica Hines, fine. Russell Tovey, fine. Ruth, fine. But we've got all of them. And then we've got Emma Thompson in as well. It's absolutely gobsmacking, this list of people. I can't believe, every day I'd be astonished by who I was getting to work with. And they are the finest standards. And at the same time, young talent as well, like Lydia, who plays the daughter Bethany, this is her first television job, I think. And she's astonishing. She's absolutely amazing. Tania, who plays Celeste, has not been a lead on BBC One, I think, before. So it's just really exciting. And again, part of the thrill of my job, I get to work with these people. Can you imagine?
One of the things that is so often praised about your work is the way in which it not only entertains, but it also explores complex social themes and pushes boundaries in terms of representation on television. I'm curious if you feel that is the responsibility of a storyteller or just incidental to telling the stories that you want to tell to begin with.
Actually, I do think it is a responsibility to get formal about it, which I don't like to do because I hope I express that on screen with a lot of joy and a lot of fun and a lot of satire sometimes. But actually, I think you do have to set yourself quotas. I believe in that. I think you do have to have a word with yourself. Quota sounds boring. What I mean is you have to have a little word with yourself saying you're very lucky, little white man sitting there with a very nice wage, and the world is very diverse and the world is changing rapidly, and where is it on screen? I still watch television programme thinking, where are you? Where's all the different heights and shapes and sizes and sexes? So I take that on board joyously. It's not my issue. It's not my politics to do that. It's my absolute joy.
For Whovians, it's been a very exciting time on New Doctor. I'm curious how you feel about that, because I think for a lot of fans, the change in gender was something that had been long debated and discussed, and I'm curious how you feel about that in terms of how, going back to what you were just saying, how important that is in terms of representation and pushing forward the narrative and the social discussion.
Again, I loved Jodie Whittaker. I thought it was the most brilliant thing to do, and again, I love the fact that beforehand it's so politicized and so tense, and that online voice dominates. Is this, and actually the press misrepresent the online voice by saying, is this a problem, is it not? Then she comes on air and everyone who ever worried looks stupid, because she just blows all those cobwebs away, and she's joyous and funny and full of life, and it just shows what nonsense is talked. You remember the people didn't think Daniel Craig could be James Bond because he was blonde? It's like, we are full of nonsense, and actually it tires me that we spend so much time talking about the nonsense. The journalism is full of talking about the nonsense. Let's look at the good stuff, which is massive, brilliant, brilliant woman. I've never met Jodie Whittaker. I'd love to meet her.
So we're here at the BFI specifically celebrating the good stuff on our small screen. I'm curious what you think, as a creative medium, television offers both storytellers and an audience they perhaps don't get from other formats of entertainment.
It's hard, because I can't compare with film, or I can't compare with novels, particularly because I've only worked in television, so I'm obviously going to fly television's flag, but I consume that other stuff, and each to their own. I love a good film, I love a good television series, and obviously in television we can be long form. Obviously there is tons of television, there is so much now. It's hard to get heard, but the invention and that's piling into television at the moment in comedy, we've just been lucky enough to live in the age of Fleabag. We have all of us been alive while 6 episodes of Fleabag were downloaded or transmitted on BBC One at 10:35. That is a miracle. It's like being around seeing the first transmission of Fawlty Towers. Well, actually, it's not like anything, because that show isn't like anything else, and that's glorious. That's an honour. That's your licence fee single-handedly paid for with those 6 half hours. So happy days.
Feels rude to ask when you've just birthed another fantastic piece of television, but looking to the future, are there other projects that you have in development, other things looking to the future? I mean, you said you haven't worked in film before. I think fans are hoping one day we might get that to happen.
Oh, I wonder. No, I've got a new project lined up, but you sound almost bad luck to talk about them now. At the moment, it's all about years and years. This year is years and years. It's the year of years and years.
Overall, what are you most hoping an audience fundamentally takes away from the experience of this show?
I hope they love the family. I hope in 20 years' time they'll be going, do you remember the Lyons family? Remember everything they went through? Remember Gran and the sons and the daughters and the children and how they survived? It's those actors and those characters. You just want that love in the end. That's what you want.